This morning, police raids across Melbourne. A bikie gang targeted over the murder of a hard-working greengrocer and father. Disgraced former New South Wales Minister Milton Orkopoulos arrested and charged just a month after being paroled on child sex crimes. And Harry threatens to sue the media for publishing photos of his wife Meghan out walking her dogs.
This is 7 News with Angela Cox.
Good morning. Two bikies have been charged with murder after dramatic police raids in Melbourne this morning. Laurel Irving has the latest. Good morning, Laurel. Police believe they've solved this brutal crime.
Good morning, Ange. Yes, they say they aren't likely to make any more arrests in this investigation, so this is a significant breakthrough. They've arrested and charged a 35-year-old man from Kilsyth in Melbourne's east and a 29-year-old man from Port Melbourne with the murder of 46-year-old father of two, Paul Vergona, in November last year. It came after a raids on 12 different locations across Melbourne early this morning, including two clubhouses of the Mongols Motorcycle Club. In fact, both these men charged with murder have links to that clubhouse. Police say they've also seized a number of illegal firearms and a speedboat, and they say they have arrested a third man as well on illegal firearm charges. The murder of Paul Vergona was genuinely shocking. The fruiterer shot dead through his car, his van, at 2 a.m. coming out of the Eastlink tunnel. And while this is certainly a major breakthrough in the investigation, what's still not clear now is any sort of motive. Police won't speculate publicly, and it may well be that this was a case of mistaken identity.
Mr. Vergona has no criminal associates, and there's nothing in his background that would suggest that anything he or his family have done have been part of the reason why he's been the victim of this heinous crime.
So these two men are now in custody at the Melbourne Magistrates Court. They're likely to appear there in the next few hours, Ange.
Okay, thank you, Laurel. Former New South Wales Labor Minister and convicted paedophile Milton Orkopoulos has been charged with failing to adhere to his parole conditions. He's accused of failing to report information to authorities. Peter Fegan has the details.
Well, detectives arrested Orkopoulos at a home in Sydney's east this morning. Yesterday we reported that Orkopoulos had allegedly breached his parole conditions he was handed when he was released from jail. Sources have told 7 News that the 62-year-old was allegedly using a form of social media, which he's prohibited from doing. Now, this morning, the State Parole Authority had a meeting behind closed doors to discuss revoking his parole. I can now tell you that they've decided to stand that over until he appears in court on the 4th of March. Now, a short while ago, he was released from Maroubra Police Station after being questioned by detectives this morning. Now, Orkopoulos served almost 12 years in jail for multiple sex and drug offences. He was only released from prison in December last year.
A Brisbane man has been released from isolation, with doctors now confident he's not infected with the new Chinese coronavirus. It comes as the first case of the potentially deadly virus is confirmed in the United States, and authorities start screening passengers arriving into Sydney from China. Samantha Brett has more.
Well, authorities are extremely concerned about the rapid spread of the coronavirus, which has already claimed 6 lives, and more than 300 people have now contracted the virus in at least 4 countries. The latest victim from the United States that recently travelled to Wuhan, which is the province that it is believed that this virus originated from in central China. Thousands of people are expected to travel from China to Australia, in particular Sydney, to celebrate the Chinese New Year over the next few days. And in fact, there are 3 flights every single week from Wuhan to Sydney. So certainly security has been ramped up here at Sydney International Airport. Every person that arrives from that region will be screened by biosecurity staff for any flu-like symptoms. It is thought that a Brisbane man may have contracted the virus after he returned from the region, but he has now been cleared and has been taken out of isolation.
This virus is likely to have come from an animal species where they also exist. We don't know yet which animal species, but in that city of China, it's probably mutated and been able to cross over into humans.
Prime Minister Scott Morrison has actually raised the alert level to level 2 for anyone wanting to travel to that region. So that means if you are travelling there, exercise extreme caution.
Senior ministers are defending their Nationals colleague, Bridget McKenzie, who's facing renewed calls to resign over the sports rort scandal. It's now been revealed she approved a cash boost for her own shooting club.
A minister in the firing line. Bridget McKenzie's passion for shooting, the target of fresh scrutiny, with reports she approved a $36,000 grant for her own gun club, helping fund new toilets at the Wangaratta Clay Target Club in Victoria, warmly welcomed by the owners. On the wish list for a long, long time, a special thank you to Senator Bridget McKenzie. But she failed to publicly declare she'd joined the club a month earlier as a full fee-paying member, according to its website.
There needs to be an understanding of all the circumstances before everyone becomes judge, jury and executioner.
The funding, among $100 million worth of sports grants she issued before the election to help secure marginal seats.
I think we need to work through this in a calm, methodical way.
Colleagues standing by her for now, but Labor says her position is untenable.
Look, I respectfully disagree.
The Prime Minister is trying to hose down this internal fire as the bushfire crisis still looms, under pressure to show further leadership as the country burns.
He's flagged a national system to track the progress of hazard reduction burns.
Ensuring we're addressing hazard reduction as much as we're addressing emissions reduction.
To be examined by a soon-to-be-announced Royal Commission into the fires, using the findings to better prepare for next year's season. Olivia Leeming, 7 News.
The impeachment trial of President Donald Trump is underway in the US Senate. During the heated debate, there was a small victory for the Democrats, who managed to have the hearing extended by a day. US Bureau Chief Ashley Mullaney has more.
It's a trial months in the making, and today the president's legal team went head to head with Democrats here on Capitol Hill. In what was largely a procedural hearing, the Senate has spent today debating the rules of the president's trial. Each side will have 24 hours over 3 days instead of two to make their case. Still, no witnesses called, infuriating Democrats who say this trial is simply a cover-up for the president's wrongdoing.
He would hide graphic evidence of his dangerous misconduct.
It's outrageous. And the American people won't stand for it, I'll tell you that right now. They're not here to steal one election. They're here to steal two elections. It's buried in the small print of their ridiculous articles of impeachment.
It's widely expected Donald Trump will be acquitted of these charges, abuse of power and obstruction of Congress. Still, he's watching closely from the sidelines of Davos, not D.C., where he addressed the World Economic Forum today.
We're here meeting with world leaders, the biggest, most important people in the world, and we're bringing back tremendous business in the United States, and they're all here to see. I'll be making a speech, and then we'll be leaving shortly. But I think it's very important. The other's just a hoax. It's the witch hunt that's been going on for years, and it's frankly disgraceful.
Donald Trump is due back in Washington tomorrow afternoon. His trial set to continue into next week.
Harry and Meghan are enjoying their first full day together on an exclusive island off Canada. But the transition into their new life hasn't been smooth. They're already threatening to sue the world's media for publishing pictures of Meghan walking her dogs. Amelia Brace reports.
Well, day one of their new life here on Vancouver Island, and the Sussexes say it's already untenable. They're threatening legal action against paparazzi who they say have been camped outside their multi-million dollar mansion following their every move. Meghan particularly angry over these photos of she and Archie taking the dogs for a walk in a local park. She says she was stalked and spied upon by a photographer who was hiding in the bushes and then ambushed her to get the shots. The couple also fears photographers may be using long lenses to try to get shots inside their home, with the statement also citing photographers' driving habits as an area of concern. Locals here on the island also becoming fed up with the huge paparazzi presence.
It's weird. There's been so many people around. It's never like that.
I think we just treat them like ourselves, and If they're walking the streets, that's fine. And if they say good morning, we'll say good morning. And
well, the threat of legal action may scare off the press in the UK. Privacy laws are much more lax here in Canada, meaning that the couple should expect the unwanted attention to continue.
Next in 7 News, hopes of a new weapon against breast cancer with promising results from a drug already in use. And President Trump and Greta Thunberg trade barbs at the Davos World Economic Forum. In breaking news, a woman is fighting for life after being ejected from a car during a horror crash in Sydney's southwest. The woman, believed to be aged in her 20s, suffered critical head injuries when two trucks and a car collided on Henry Lawson Drive in Milperra. Five ambulance crews have been tasked to the accident. They will rush her to Liverpool Hospital. Henry Lawson Drive is now closed in both directions. Melbourne researchers have discovered a pill targeting anxiety and high blood pressure can also slow the spread of cancer cells. The breakthrough involves beta blockers, which work by stopping the body's natural response to stress. 60 women diagnosed with breast cancer took part in the trial. It found a correlation between those who took the drug and a decrease in the spread of cancer cells. To finance now, and joining me is Bill Evans, Chief Economist at Westpac. Good morning to you, Bill. How are the markets responding to the release of the Westpac Consumer Sentiment Index?
Consumer sentiment was down 1.8%. I think markets were expecting the fall to be larger, particularly given when we saw the Queensland floods, confidence was down by nearly 6%. But with those floods, the level of confidence was very high, and so you could expect to see a bigger fall. This time, confidence has started off very low, and indeed the level we have now of 93.6 is, we've only had seven occasions where it's been that low since 2009. So a smaller fall than expected, but certainly reasons why that fall should have been expected to be lower. Markets liked it, and the market is up now 0.4% compared to a US lead of minus 0.5% driven by that coronavirus. We still expect the Reserve Bank will be in a position to cut interest rates when they meet again on the 4th of February. Thanks, Ange.
Okay, Bill Evans at Westpac, thank you. Donald Trump has taken a swipe at climate change campaigner Greta Thunberg during his speech at the Davos World Economic Forum. The president lashed out at what he called environmental prophets of doom before the teenager hit back. Sarah Greenalch has more.
Well, this was the first time Greta Thunberg and Donald Trump have come face to face since the 17-year-old famously stared down the US president at the UN summit in New York last year. Today at this meeting in Switzerland, the mood was much the same. Set against the backdrop of Australia's devastating bushfires, Greta Thunberg ripped into world leaders, accusing them of inaction.
Planting trees is good, of course, but it's nowhere near enough of what is needed. And it cannot replace real mitigation and rewilding nature.
Her speech came shortly after the US president took a swipe at the teenage climate change activist while she was sitting in the audience.
But to embrace the possibilities of tomorrow, we must reject the perennial prophets of doom and their predictions of the apocalypse. They are the heirs of yesterday's foolish fortune tellers.
The aim of the four-day forum, which is often referred to as a talk fest in the snow, is to broadly improve the state of the world. It's focusing on issues like global trade wars, debt levels, inequality and tensions in the Middle East. But by far the issue dominating discussions is climate change. Australia is being represented by Finance Minister Matthias Cormann, who on several occasions today was forced to defend the federal government's handling of the bushfire crisis, continuing to spark debate even on the other side of the world.
Next in 7 News Sport with Jim Wilson, including Nick Kyrgios joins nine other Aussies in the second round of the Australian Open. Plus, the terrifying moment in the Big Bash that sent a young gun to hospital.
Good morning, everyone. Nick Kyrgios led the charge as 10 Aussies progressed to the second round of the Australian Open. Kyrgios started his campaign in style against Lorenzo Sonego, knocking off the Italian in straight sets. The world number 26 got emotional after John McEnroe thanked him for his role raising money for the bushfire crisis.
But I just wanted to tell you personally that I'm proud of you.
I appreciate that. You'll make me tear up again.
Alexi Popperin progressed after former finalist Joe Wilfred Tsonga retired hurt when trailing 2 sets to 1.
That's a painful one, man. I've never felt like this after a match. He was my favourite player as a kid.
After his straight sets win over Marco Cecchinato, 7th seed Alexander Zverev pledged $10,000 for every win to bushfire relief and his entire paycheck if he wins the Australian Open. That is a great gesture. A frightening mid-match collision in the Big Bash has put a Melbourne Renegade star in hospital. The Hobart Hurricanes stumped their way to 3 for 190. Not even the security guard safe, but it was the 4th over of the Renegades chase that left the crowd holding their breath after Sam Harper collided with Hurricanes bowler Nathan Ellis.
Harper, huge collision. And he's gone down heavily here.
I've never seen a concussion in a cricket game like that, where it's more football or rugby than when you get taken out from underneath.
Now, Harper wanted to continue, but was forced off by the doctors and sent to hospital with concussion. The Hurricanes went on to win a thriller by 4 runs. Well, the finals race is heating up. That win moves the Hurricanes to within 2 points of the 5th-place Sydney Thunder. The top 5 teams qualify for the revamped finals series. Tonight, the Adelaide Strikers host ladder leaders the Melbourne Stars. Big game this. It's live and free across the screens of 7. The Ollieroos can clinch a spot at the Tokyo Olympics tonight with a win over South Korea in the semi-finals of the Under-23 Asian Football Championship in Thailand.
We don't even talk about Olympic qualification. We talk about winning the Asian Cup or getting to the final of the Asian Cup, and the rest will look after itself.
Good luck to the Ollieroos. Now, if the Aussies lose, they'll get another chance to book their ticket to Tokyo in the 3rd-place playoff. It was a rough return to Stamford Bridge for former Chelsea star David Luiz. The Arsenal defender gave away a penalty and was sent off as the Blues took an early lead. But the Gunners fought back from behind twice with only 10 men to earn a 2-2 draw.
Hector Bellerin!
Socceroo Aaron Moy scored a cracking goal in Brighton's 3-1 loss to Bournemouth, and Manchester City cut Liverpool's Premier League lead to 13 points with a 1-0 win over Sheffield United. Irishman Sam Bennett will wear the leader's jersey in today's second stage of the Tour Down Under. The riders will travel 136 kilometres from Woodside to Stirling in South Australia. The opening stage was a relatively relaxed 150-kilometre ride through the Barossa Valley. Bennett took control late, winning a furious sprint finish. You can watch Stage 2 live and free on 7 today. Plenty of cycling and the Big Bash tonight. And a whole lot more sport coming your way at 4 and 6, Ange.
Good stuff. Thanks so much, Jim. Next in 7's Morning News, the National Weather Forecast with David Brown. A stray dog in Georgia has become an internet sensation for his helpful ways after he was filmed chaperoning students on the way to school. Kersha regularly walks alongside a group of kindergarten students, making sure it's safe to pass and telling off drivers when it's not. Once all cars have come to a stop, Kersha encourages the students to cross. What a cutie. Now, let's get a check of the weather forecast now with 7 News meteorologist David Brown. How's it looking, Brownie?
Yes, good morning, Ange. An active cold front is now sweeping across the southern states, and it's whipping up some rather windy weather. As we go to the radar, you'll notice it's already through Adelaide. It's also producing some patchy rain across the Mallee country of Victoria. Got some rain entering the southwest corner of Victoria as well. I think we'll see it sweep into the, well, into the southern capital towards evening. Some good falls are on the way. Let's go to the weather wall now. In fact, we're expecting a hot and sunny day in Brisbane, a maximum 34 degrees. Sydney, well, the Harbour City is turning it on again. Another beautiful day, already reached that forecast high of 29 degrees. In Melbourne, strong and gusty northerly winds today, 32 degrees. That gusty, cool change with rain pushing through, as I mentioned, probably after about 6 o'clock this evening. And as we fly into Perth, fine, partly cloudy conditions and around 25 degrees. Hot and gusty northerly winds are also sweeping across outback New South Wales and, of course, into Victoria. This is the cool, gusty southwesterly change running behind it. I think as it moves through later today, it has the potential to whip up a dust storm through outback New South Wales late this afternoon into the evening as it gradually pushes through. But in sharp contrast, look at all the rain falling through parts of Victoria. especially in Tasmania. More showers and storms continuing through large parts of eastern Queensland. So for the Capitals tomorrow, we're expecting fine conditions in Brisbane, around 33 degrees. Wet for Hobart, 21 degrees. Wet in Melbourne as well, also 21 degrees. Sunshine for Perth and 27. That's latest weather. More details, 4 o'clock, Ange.
OK, thank you, Brownie. And that is 7 News to Now. We'll keep you up to date throughout the day. I'm Angela Cox. Thanks so much for your company. Have a great day.